very special online edition of Elevate. I'm Pastor Derek, and joining me is a very special guest. You know him. You love him. It's Noah.
And
okay, so I know it's a bummer that we can't be all together in the same room, but this time gives us an opportunity to be creative in how we grow and support each other as a community.
And we are also going to be doing Elevate Online next week as well. But after that, we are going to take things week by week. So make sure that you follow us on Instagram, LNC_Elevate, and subscribe to our texting service, Elevate Students. Text Elevate Students to 31996. And you can also go to elevateparents.org for your parents.
Yeah. As you know, information is changing constantly, so check out those three ways that we communicate with you: the texting service, Instagram, and elevateparents.org. And if you missed all that, it was written underneath the screen. You can check that out. Well, let's talk about some announcements, all right? First of all, bad news. You might have seen it posted earlier today, but you probably saw this coming, but MRT20, yeah, it's canceled. I'm so sorry, I'm bummed too. But it is canceled for this year, and if you already made a payment, we're gonna be voiding those checks and getting them back to you, so don't worry about that. So just the reality of some things going on, but MRT is canceled for this year.
But we have good news. As of right now, Divers is still happening on Saturday. So This Saturday, 10 a.m. to noon, it'll be at Pastor Derek's home. So please come. It'll be very enjoyable. So as of right now, it's still on.
Yeah, as of now, we're good. We'll see. We'll keep you posted if that changes, all right? Also, we want to give you a chance to interact in some fun way. And so we're going to be having a video contest for this week. I want you to film and send us your best hand washing video. That's some good hand washing. Are you singing Happy Birthday?
I am.
Right? How many times? Twice, right?
That's my preferred song.
It's your preferred song. Yeah. So you're supposed to sing. Yeah. So any creative way you want to shoot a funny video, your best hand washing video, send it to me, Pastor Derek. You can send it to me. If you don't have my cell number, you can just post it and just make sure you tag Elevate on Instagram and make sure we see it there. And the videos that we like, we're going to be highlighting and showing next week at Elevate Online. So get those videos to us. So again, send us your best hand washing videos. Cool? Well, you know, we usually have a game during Elevate, don't we?
We do. I think so. I love them.
Yeah. So we don't want, you know, something like being online and not all in the same room keep us from playing a game. So you may have seen it already posted, but if you go onto our Instagram, in our Instagram stories, you will see a game about famous neighbors from different TV shows and such. So if you want to play it right now, pause this. Don't play it during it. Pause it if you're going to go over there. Pause this and go over there, or you can play it after. It'll be available. Just a fun way to, we're not going to let something like, you know, what's that called? Social, what's it?
Quarantining?
No, not quarantining. That's the extreme word. The
social distancing.
Social distancing. That's the word. How did I not? Quarantine! No, social distancing. That's the word.
It's not getting too extreme.
Yeah, we haven't gotten that far yet. But social distancing, we're not going to let that keep us from playing a game.
No.
Because we're, yeah, so you can head over there, play a game on that.
And as we head into this, pause it if you're going to play the game, but if not, we're going to head into prayer. So, dear Lord, thank you for being able to get this platform so that we can continue to meet on this Wednesday night, whether you're watching this now or maybe, you know, Thursday. I pray that you continue to reach all these students to know that as they're distancing themselves socially, that we are still together as a church, and that as we continue to go through this, that we are grateful and at peace, that it'll be well as long as we follow you. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. Neighbor. You might be thinking of a neighbor from your favorite TV show, or maybe literally the person who lives beside you, and that might give you good feelings or bad feelings, depending on your situation. Maybe because you just played that game on Instagram, maybe you're thinking of some of those neighbors that you couldn't remember from the game. You know, when I think of neighbor, I think of Mr. Rogers. You know what I'm talking about? I mean, this guy, he still, to this day, even after he's passed on, even after his show's been not being filmed for years, he still has a huge influence going. They just came out with a movie about him called A Beautiful Day in the Neighborhood. And I know a lot of you have a lot of extra time in your hands. I encourage you, if you're going to watch a movie, that's a pretty good movie. It's pretty awesome. You know, he's still being quoted today. I'm amazed at people's fascination with him in 2020 of Mr. Rogers. His influence is still continuing. I was just at the dentist for my kids, and it was a pediatrician dentist, and along the wall they had all these quotes, and every single one of them was from Mr. Rogers. And they're awesome quotes, a lot of wisdom in that. I remember being a kid and watching Mr. Rogers. I watched him almost every day. My mom actually watched it with us, and I remember her saying she was very sad when we were too old to watch it because she would want to watch it just on her own. We're like, hey, no judgment, Mom. If you want to watch him, watch him. That's cool. And you probably know this song, even if you haven't really watched the show. It's a very popular song, and you just heard like the musical part of it in the bumper video, but his song he opened every show with, which he asked, won't you be my neighbor, right? You know, won't you be my neighbor? You know, the fast, crappy song version that I just did. He asked this question every day, won't you be my neighbor? He's saying, I'm inviting you to be my neighbor. I want to be your neighbor. And we might be thinking, oh, that's nice. Inviting kids to live next to him, being a part of this safe neighborhood, because maybe they're coming from a rough area and their lives, there's a lot of stuff going on. But when you realize that Fred Rogers was a Christ follower, and actually, he was an ordained minister. That question starts to have more meaning. See, Fred Rogers saw his show and what he did as him living out his calling to share the love of Jesus. His calling, he felt called to ministry. And he was. And his show was his ministry. And in his biography, it talks about how everything he did on the show was very intentional. He was very creative in how he got very complex issues talked about in a very non-confrontational way. He was, I would almost call it creatively sneaky with it. You know, there are so many things. I mean, he took on racism, he took on war, death, these tough things, and talked to children about it in a very redemptive, Christ-centered way. And yet he never really said the name Jesus. He lived out what it means to be a Christ follower. It makes me think that when he was asking for kids to be his neighbor, well, all of us, not just kids, all of us, that when he was asking that question, he was inviting us into something so much deeper than just living beside him. He was referring to what Jesus means by neighbor in this parable called the Parable of the Good Samaritan.
The Parable of the Good Samaritan can be found in Luke 10, 25 to 37. One day, an expert in religious law stood up to test Jesus by asking him this question. Teacher, what should I do to inherit eternal life? Jesus replied, what does the law of Moses say? How do you read it? The man answered, well, you must love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, all your strength, and all your mind. And love your neighbor as yourself. Right, Jesus told him, do this and you will live. The man wanted to justify his actions, so he asked Jesus, well, and who is my neighbor? Jesus replied with a story. A Jewish man was traveling from Jerusalem down to Jericho, and he was attacked by bandits. They stripped him of his clothes, they beat him up, and left him dead beside the road. By chance, a priest came along. But when he saw the man lying there, he crossed to the other side of the road and passed him by. Then a temple assistant walked over and looked at him lying there. But he also passed on the other side. Then a despised Samaritan came along, and when he saw the man, he felt compassion for him. Going over to him, the Samaritan soothed his wounds with olive oil, bandaged him up, and then he put the man on his donkey, took him to an inn, where he took care of him. The next day, he handed the innkeeper 2 silver coins, telling him, take care of this man. If his bill runs higher than this, I'll pay you next time I'm here. Now, which of these three would you say was a neighbor to the man who was attacked by bandits? Jesus asked. The man replied, the one who showed him mercy. And then Jesus said, yes, now go and do the same. Right here, we see three different characters that interact with this man. The first one, he doesn't necessarily just look at him and walk by. He goes to the other side of the road and then continues walking. So he's not even walking near him. And then, well, the second one, it says that he does likewise. You know, it might be different back then. They might be seen as unclean as they're priests and, you know, those working in the temple where they need to be clean and they need to be holy just to, you know, be in there, to be a part of this, to be a leader, or even be an assistant. But the third one didn't really care about all this. The Samaritan, the one who was actually despised, didn't necessarily stop. He stopped, he poured olive oil on his wounds, took him on his donkey, and then said, you know, if his bill runs higher than this, I'll pay for it. This reminds me of what, you know, we could be as people. When we see the people that aren't necessarily our favorites or, you know, deemed by society as just pretty weird, we don't want to necessarily put ourselves next to them. Or even, you know, if we see them in a time of struggle, whether it be mentally or they're hurt physically like this man, we want to, you know, go to the other side of the road. But Jesus says, even the Pharisee, who was, you know, the expert in the religious law, when he is asked which one of these is the good neighbor, he replies, the one who showed him mercy. So why not we go and do the same?
It's important to remember how subversive and controversial making a Samaritan the hero of a story would have been to Jesus' audience. He wasn't supposed to be the hero, but he was someone who understood what it means to be a neighbor as Jesus was trying to teach. And I think what Mr. Rogers was trying to continue to teach, coming out of his relationship as a Christ follower himself. You know, in the movie that recently came out, Tom Hanks plays Mr. Rogers. One of my favorite scenes, and there are a lot of good scenes in that movie, but one of my favorite scenes is when the reporter is having a conversation with Mr. Rogers' wife. And he asks her, he goes, what is it like to be married to a living saint? And her response is so good. She goes, I don't like that term, living saint, because to call him that makes what he does in his life unattainable. She goes, he wasn't born Mr. Rogers. He works at it every day. He chooses every day to pray. He chooses every day to read scripture, to go swimming, to play the piano, to work on who he is. She then even talks about it. He has junk in his life that he works on, but he chooses to work on it. And it's a great lesson in that it's attainable. We don't want to elevate Mr. Rogers to the point that says, well, it would be cool to be like him, but that's not attainable. He is a Christ follower. He's someone who says, I'm going to work at being who God called me to be. I'm going to be a neighbor to those who don't deserve it, who I struggle with, because that is me living out my faith. But he was willing to make a choice every day to work on being a neighbor, because that doesn't always come naturally. You don't just wake up one day and this comes easy. The Good Samaritan, he didn't wake up that morning and just also say, I'm gonna be someone who's gonna be neighborly to somebody. This would have taken time to work on, because to the point that even when it was dangerous for him, because it was dangerous for him to stop and help, because there could have been bandits still there that would have gotten him. It was risky for him as a Samaritan to engage with this person. But that just became a response because he worked on who he is to be who God called us to be neighbors to each other, to share his love. And that involves this word, discipline.
And discipline you can look at it as being, you know, a child, a kid to your parents, and they discipline you for doing something wrong, but it's necessarily more than that. as students, as athletes, as scholars, I believe we all have some sort of discipline in our life, whether it's studying, finding a specific schedule for that. Mine was when I was an athlete. You know, used to be an athlete for college before a program was shut down. But during those first two semesters of being so, I would wake up. I would go at 5 a.m., go to the gym with my whole team. We would go work out, do all these same things together, disciplined workouts together that we would do as a team. Then we would go team breakfast, do our schedule throughout the day, which involved classes. Then immediately after classes are done, we would meet in the locker room, head to the field, and then before even reaching the field, we would stop in the gym, do 500 wall balls, both hands. Then head to the field where we had to know our drills, and if not, well, I guess we were running that day. That is just discipline. That is knowing what to do and practicing your craft so you then become better and better at it. So discipline is something that is not necessarily negative because we did something wrong. It is, you know, making sure nothing wrong happens and staying on this schedule, learning your craft and becoming better at it, which in turns, discipline is something good. Discipline doesn't really mean that we're getting into trouble. It just means you're working on something that you care about.
It's so important to remember, discipline has a lot of negative connotations to it. But what we're talking about is not getting in trouble. What we're talking about is working at something that you care about. So do we care enough about being who God calls us to be, which is neighbors to each other, as He means neighbors, to actually work at it? So let's get practical a little bit. Let's look at some ways that we can work at being neighbors to others. First of all, let's look at the example that I shared earlier from Mr. Rogers' life. Pray for each other. God calls us to pray for each other. You know, whether it's someone that you know is in need, start off helping them first by praying for them. And then that opens your eyes to action to actually get involved and help in ways that you can help, that God leads you. Maybe it's someone that you're struggling with, that you really have issues with. Pray for them. And I don't mean in the stage of, Lord, help all the people I struggle with, or like, you know, getting vague with it. Get specific, because that helps us grow. And God wants to get specific with you. And so I would encourage you to write them down. Maybe get a little notebook. Write down people and situations you want to pray for. Actually pray for them by name every day. I love this little, there's this little montage where they actually show Mr. Rogers quietly praying for people in his life that he meets. And some of these people, he just has this little interaction with, but he knows, hey, they need prayer, because we all do. So pray for each other. Maybe you need like an actual, just get a little notebook. I have a little notebook that I like. I actually use physical paper so I'm not distracted by what's on my phone. But maybe you start with your phone. Most phones have a notes app in them. You know, just write it down. I remember there was a youth worker friend of mine, and we were talking and I shared a need that was going on, and he put it in his phone. I talked to him again 2 years later, and he said, hey, How's it going with that? He referred to it again. I said, oh, it's been great. And I updated him on the situation. He goes, great. He goes, so can I take that situation off my prayer list? And I said, wait, it's still, you've been praying? He goes, yeah, I've been praying for you for 2 years. And that was so meaningful and powerful. So one of the first ways that we work at being a neighbor, because when we pray for other people, that gives us more of a heart to say, how can I help you? Instead of, how can I avoid you? How can I just deal, you know, sometimes we just think, you know, people are just a problem to avoid, but really there are people that we're called to pray for. And also, it doesn't matter how many social distancing they tell us to take, you can always pray for them, no matter how far away you are from them, right? And then a second is spend time in God's Word. I know some of you guys are like, well, you know, we're supposed to pray, we're supposed to read the Bible, but guys, seriously, this is the time to maybe get into a healthy routine. You may be like, man, my life's been so crazy, I've been able to spend quiet time with God. Guys, your schedule's just opened up a little bit, right? So get into God's Word. It helps us to see the world. We talked about this at retreat, through the lens of Jesus. Seeing how can I be a neighbor, as Jesus teaches me to be a neighbor to others. A third way to work at being a neighbor to others is to do things that feed your soul. God created you uniquely you. Do something that feeds your soul and reminds you that you're not a machine. You're not defined by what you accomplish or what you earn. You are defined by who created you and loves you. So do things that, maybe that's getting outside. Maybe that is, you know, working out. Some of you guys, that just helps you get into a good place. You know, it's amazing though. Let me say, your physical well-being affects your spiritual attitude in a lot of ways. So, you know, our physical selves and spiritual selves, they're connected. So there's something to that. Maybe reading a good book or whatever feeds your soul, do it, and that you're able to do. Number four, exercise healthy ways to express your feelings. This was a big theme in Mr. Rogers' show. But really think about, how can I find healthy ways to express my feelings that are not destructive, that don't hurt others, that don't hurt myself? Small ways that we can work at this to be a neighbor to other people and a neighbor to ourselves. How to love ourselves too. And last one, number five, take small steps to help those in need around you. This might be like, well, yeah, we're supposed to help each other. But no, sometimes we think we get overwhelmed by the needs around us. Start taking the small steps that you can help those around you. Do the tangible good that's right in front of you. And then it's amazing how God gives you more opportunities to help others, to show love to others. And just the small ways. Maybe right now you might be like, well, I can't help anybody because I'm just stuck in my house with my family. Guess what? You can help your family. And you're like, ugh. I'm supposed to be a neighbor to my family? Yeah, even that annoying sibling that might be bothering you right now while you're watching this. How can you take small steps to show love and be a neighbor to your younger sister, to your older brother, to your mom, to your dad, to your cousin, to your grandma that's in the house with you, anybody, or to that neighbor that may be shut in right now and needs a little bit of help getting something that they need? Take the small steps. And it's amazing, the more and more we do this, the more and more our eyes are open to see how we can be neighbors to others. It's amazing. I think so many of us, if we were in that Good Samaritan shoes, it wouldn't be that we'd make a choice necessarily, say, see the need and make a choice not to help. Some of us would be so distracted and so self-involved, I think we wouldn't even notice. And so this is helping us get a lens that says, how can I be a neighbor? How can I help someone else? You guys know we've been talking about our 2020 theme is, how can we leave it better than we found it? And that's what this whole thing's about. How can we just, in small ways, as Christ followers, leave things better than we found it? You know, we're in a unique time right now in our world. You know, a lot of stuff's going on. But this time gives us, as Christ followers, a unique opportunity to be creative in how we be a neighbor to others as Jesus teaches us. So I encourage you, be creative. Think through. This is an opportunity for the church to step up and be the church. Be a shining light of love and of hope, and to be neighbors to those around us. So, for you, how can you be someone's neighbor this week? I encourage you to take these steps to work on being a neighbor and to think tangibly, how can I be neighbor to those around me this week? Let's pray. Dear Lord, thank you so much for the blessing it is that we have technology that we can connect together and be together even though we can't physically be in the same room. Lord, be with us. Help us to be a neighbor to each other and to share love in very practical ways in the opportunities we have, starting in our own homes and beyond. Lord, thank you, Lord, that we don't have to live in fear right now, that we don't have to be enslaved by it because we have hope, we have joy in you. And so, Lord, be with us as we reflect on what you have taught us and showed us together. Lord, help us to just share your love and work on being a neighbor as you taught us to be. It's in your holy name we pray. Amen. And before we go, as we do every week, remind you guys that you matter, you belong, and God has a purpose for your life. And love you guys. And don't forget to head over to Instagram to the stories to interact with questions. And we will be doing this again next week. Can't wait to hear from you. Guys, be safe. Love you. And we'll see you.